ons. All right, guys, there goes the signal. That signal that's indicative of the fact that I'm live. Well, recording. I shouldn't say live. I don't think recording is live. But yeah, it's good to be back. This is the third clip, if I'm not mistaken, I'm recording for you guys under this pupillage training. And although time has got no impact on you, it is in the same week I did a first two. And this one is going to be all about code of conduct. So we're going to spend a little bit of time on that. But before we go there, it is imperative that we make a few announcements about this training. And we're going to be making a lot of announcements. Every time I do a clip, specifically, there will be important announcements before I start with the subject matter. And that is why then that you must look at all the clips. If you see my name is linked to a clip, it's not that I'm important. I'm just the guy that's been given the instructions to do it. I've got a couple of slave drivers here, but I love them to bits, no problem. All right, so I'm not alone here in studio. I've got Mrs. Tasha Rustov here on my side, a quality and assurance manager of the institution. Quality and doing assurance management on what I'm doing here. And then always nice to have her around. We can quickly ask her a question if we want to know things. And then I also invite her. If I say something that's wrong in terms of the announcements, dates, and so on, she can actually just say, hey, it's not like that. So it's informative. We are trying to create a situation where you're listening to this and you're not falling asleep. All right, guys, but I'm excited to be here. I'm always excited a bit to talk to you. And I hope you, after listening to the first clip, the introduction, the second clip, the overview, this one is going to be the National Curriculum 2020 on the Code of Conduct specifically for pupils. And I hope that at this stage, you're very happy you've made this decision in your life that you are going to become an advocate. Man, I applaud you. It's hard work. A lot of this work we're doing is going to be left to you. It's distance learning, but it's on a foundation of self-evaluation. This course has been brought into existence by the LPC instructions in terms of how Mrs. Rustov has set it out this morning in a meeting to prep you for the coming exams, to make you prepared for that. So a lot relies on you. A lot relies on you. You really have to listen to what we say. You really have to read everything. And if you are listening to this third clip and you've not yet started with your assignments, I'm shocked. I'm shocked. Except if you're one of those lucky guys that can stay awake at night for long hours and you've listened to all the clips in one night, you need to start. And you need to start this off the 1st of June. The 1st of June. I'm here in the week before the 1st of June making this recording for you. All right. Okay, so that's it then there. Quickly, the announcements. First of all, I'm showing you a book. Senior counsel Ismail Hussain has drafted this book through LexisNexis. It's a very good book that's going to be utilized to take you through the practical drafting skills, specifically pertaining to delictual claims and damages. So I'm going to show you the book so that you can see it. Let's see. This is not going to work. Let me go a little. Okay, there it is. Maybe you can see that. If you cannot see it totally, I'm going to swing it like that. All right, so there's a little bit of the picture there. It's not very clear, but for that intents and purposes, right, you've got to purchase this. Practical drafting skills, quickly get out there, purchase this. It's very important that you have this book. You can get it from LexisNexis, and it's on the reading list. Now, don't be alarmed. The ISBN number is on the reading list, through which you can order it. And unfortunately, this is your book that you have to purchase yourself, and you have to purchase all the other books on the reading list. Harams, Erasmus, you can purchase them. I would not purchase them. You'll be spending 100,000 rands, but this one you have to purchase electronically or in whatever format it is available. It's a very good piece of work that Judge Hussain has set up. He was also a judge in the High Supreme Court. Senior counsel that is set up, and I like the book a lot. So go and get it. You're going to need it here because one of the most important things for an advocate is to be able to draft. And then next week, which doesn't mean a lot for you in terms of time, but I'm coming back to lecture on this book. And if you have it, the latest edition of Harm's President, also on the reading list, you can have it with you when you listen to my recording. So that's the first announcement. Go buy this book. You've got to buy all the other books. I'd rather sign up with the KwaZulu-Natal Library or with the LPC Library online, because some of these books are over 20,000 rand. I don't know what you pay nowadays for a Buckle and Jones or Erasmus, but it's very expensive. All right. The next announcements I want to make is let's look at your assignments. First of all, for you to be able to get the certificate, the regulation certificate from this institution, we need to establish your competency. Now, you've got four multiple choice questions. I advise you do them immediately. Why am I advising that? If you do the four multiple choice questions on the eLead platform immediately, it's going to give you insight into the whole reading list. That will be assignment 03 and 04. And then the pupillage guide that you must work through, that will be multi-choice assignment 01 and 02. You have to do these multi-choice assignments first, because it will give you a whole idea of the introduction level, and far beyond that also, of what is in this program that you have to know about. And you will see there is many duplications. The questions are put in different ways, but everything interlinks. If you do your four multi-choice assignments first, then you will have a more solid understanding of the theoretical questions in the practical assignments. Each one of them counts out of 50. 25 marks I allocate to theoretical, and the other 25, I ask you to draft one thing. What do I mean with one thing? It's either a liquidation or sequestration application or something else. There's no two instructions there. It's one, but it's 25 marks. All right, so we're going to talk about the marks later on. Let's come back to the multi-choice. The first two, like I said, 01 and 02 is on the pupillage guide. You don't need anything else. You take that pupillage guide, you take a multi-choice one, they each count out of 100 marks. You do them out of the pupillage guide, and you finished. Multi-choice number three and number four is out of your reading list. Your reading list, like I said in clip number two on overview, if I recollect correctly, we took that reading list and divided it into five sections, and we did the next 200 questions, two assignments of 100 questions each out of there. You need to do this first, because your competency level in your multi-choice is above 50%. And the system will generate a mark for you. All right. And then, of course, if you fail your multi-choice, you will be able to write a next one and a next one until it locks down on a specific date. And that date will be into your introduction letter, not my clip. So when you fail your multi-choice, don't be alarmed. Don't be alarmed. You need to try and pass it the first time. Ladies and gentlemen, please, this is so serious. You have four multi-choice assignments and 10 practical assignments. And you have to reach a level of competency so we can give you a certificate. Are we not getting it? So this is very important what I'm saying now. You must work very hard and utilize your hours and work through these things. So the first four multi-choice, they are getting locked down, if I'm not mistaken, on the 1st July 2021. That means you cannot access them anymore. So if you get 60%, you want to do it over and get a 80%, you can do that. I would not recommend it. I would recommend that if you get above 50% in multi-choice, you go directly to the practicals, because it's a lot of work. Now, you have seven assignments you have to complete before the 1st of July 2021. It is these four multi-choice, and then they will show you which ones. It's the next three practicals. Now listen to me. The three practicals that makes up the seven is also only on the pupillage guide. All right, you only go to the pupillage guide for your theoretical questions. The practical questions does not necessarily come out of the pupillage guide. One does, the other two not. All right, so you've got seven assignments that has to be finished before the 1st of July. Four multi-choice, first two is about the pupillage guide, next two is about the reading list, and then three practical exams of 50 mark each, and they will indicate to you precisely which ones. And the theoretical questions, the first 25 marks in those three practicals, they come out of the pupillage guide. Go in there, it's easy, get those marks, establish competency. Get a 25 right, that's 50%. But how will we address competency? With an emphasis on the practical drafting. So even if you get 50% in theoretical, but your practical drafting is not in place, we might not give you competency. How does competency works? On a 4 multi-choice, above 50%, system will generate your mark, but not on the practical exams. On the practical exam, guys like me will sit and look at your work. You're going to be submitting your assignments on the eLeader platform. Precisely in the same manner than other schools like the UNISA School of Industry Institution is doing. Guys like me and other role players will go and scroll through them and declare you either competent or not competent. You're not getting a mark. All right. So it's one of those things. And one of the emphasis I'm going to place on assignments is practical drafting. Whenever we ask you to draft things, it is important that you understand that. If you cannot draft, you cannot become an advocate. I'm sorry. If you cannot do legal research to draft or draft a legal opinion on the foundation of legal research, you cannot declare you competent. But if you fail and I declare you non-competent, you will have an opportunity until the 15th of August to resubmit the non-competent assignment. We need to lock down on the 15th of August. The 15th of August, this program is locked down. Why? We cannot run until the end of August. We need you to time to sit back and say, I finished the program. Now I can concentrate on studying for the September, beginning September exam. We need to give you a break. That's why we are forcing a lockdown on the 15th. After that, I will sit and we will endeavor those resubmitted assignments to get them back to you within 7 days, which means you can still get them before you get to the exams. So how does this work? The assignments that has to be in before the 31st of July, July is the 4 multi-choice and 3 practicals. We'll show you which ones in the introduction later. And then 7 practicals before the end of July. So by the 1st of July, the first 7 has to be in. And by the 1st of August, basically the end of July, the next 7 practicals has to be in. They won't be multi-choice. And all right, I just had a glitch here. I'm going to go on. And nobody's coming in, but I had the flatliner glitch here. And it says you are recording. I don't know where this glitch came from. I'm just going to go on. Mrs. Rustoff, are you comfortable with me proceeding? Yes. I had a flat black liner glitch here, but the system shows I'm still recording. All right, Mrs. Rustoff says I can proceed because you can imagine if something goes wrong, you have to do it all over. I don't know what happened there. That was very interesting. Maybe it's all the heaters on in this place. All right, so I've said that. Né? So that's what it's all about. And the denominator in the practicals is, can you draft or not? Now, here's your tip. So you're hysterical now. You're listening to me and you're going, oh, my soul, I'm going to get 14 assignments out in 2 months. Yeah, well, you're becoming an advocate. Suck it up and get over it. We all had to do it. You chose to become an advocate. It's a step higher. It's a step further. And it's a specialized direction. So this is what we do. I mean, how many times as a practicing advocate, like I said in the first 2 clips, I had to sit until 3 o'clock in the morning and get something out that, strictly speaking, you'll do in 2 weeks. This is what you have chosen. And I believe in any event you can do it. Because if you have chosen this, that must ignite. I can do it. All right, so that's what I want to say about that. That is important. Now, here's the tip for the practicals. When you go to the eLeader platform, you will see sources, specifically Regulation 6 sources. Because of uniformity, the subject taught nowadays for attorneys and advocates in those sources are basically the same. You'll have High Court there, Mac Court, insolvency, matrimonial, personal injury, and it goes on and it goes on. Listen to me. Listen to me. Look at a practical question. In the Mac Court and the High Court, when you go into those sources under Regulation 6, there we teach you now to draft, specifically within the rules of the High Court, Mac Court, whatever the situation is. And there is a lot of examples there of how things should be done. Are you listening? Examples, templates. So first, when you go to a practical draft, you determine, is it High Court, Mac Court, what are we doing here? Then you go to that regulation source, you go look what's going on. Let's say it's a personal injury claim. It's happening in a high court. So you'll go to the high court manual and you'll go to the personal injury manual because there's a couple of things that's important with drafting. Isn't that correct? How to draft within the rules, MAC court, high court, whatever court. And then what are we doing? Is it the RAF claim? Is it the personal injury? Is it a liquidation application, sequestration application, eviction application, Anton Piller application? What are we doing here? And then you must just select that correct subject matter. Easy peasy, if I may say it as that. So that's the clue I'm giving you. So the moment you are registered, according to the way I think it's going to work, let's say you pay your fees on the on the 1st of June, and you're registered, or maybe you pay per EFT, like they said, and it takes a while for the money to reflect so they can register you, you can immediately start. And the moment you can start, the first thing I want you to do is familiarize yourself with the eLeader platform. There is one of the high-ranking members of this institution from Durban, on the AC committee, actually, from the AC committee that controls this institution, is going to put up the eLeader clip to show you how the eLeader operates. So go there and look at that and navigate your way through the whole eLeader platform, immediately going to every tab to see what is in that tab. So you can remember it. So it goes fast. All right. Okay, I've said that. Let me just look at my notes here. I'm not going to go into dates too much. There is four open sessions I'm going to have with you. These open sessions that I'm going to have with you, that will be into the introduction letter. I don't want to get too much into dates here because we have now decided, yes, the dates in front of me, but I know and understand us humans. You know, we might go and sleep tonight and tomorrow morning decide we want to change some of these dates. I don't want to commit too much to that, although we have finalized it in a meeting this morning. What I want to say is I'm going to be with you for four selected dates. From the day you register until the 13th of August. The last date I'm going to be with you is the 13th of August. And now I've actually set a date. And those time periods are going to be in the afternoon from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock. Now, that means that I'm going to go online. It's going to be an open forum. I'm going to sit in my advocacy chambers from 6 o'clock, 20 o'clock on the webinar or whatever forum we select, it's open. You can come and go and talk to me. It's going to happen four times. And in the introduction letter that will be set out, you'll see precisely what's happening there. And there you can ask me subject-related matters. What's going to happen with the assignments? When the first bunch of practical assignments are in, I'm going to see who's competent and incompetent, and I'm going to write a report of the general things I saw that was wrong, and then those people that has to resubmit can go and look at that, and if they correct that, they'll become competent in the second round around. Now, that's how we're going to operate it. So after the cutoff date of an assignment, I'm going to have about 7 days in which you declare you're competent or non-competent, and on the system, on the eLeader platform, submit my report. So if you're non-competent, you first go and read my report. What's wrong? The language, the length, the law. You don't know what you're doing. I hope that one is not up there. And then you just follow those guidelines and you do it over. All right. So that's how we're going to do it. And then right out, we'll have those four sessions at the evening so you all can get home if you're working. Do you understand why we're doing that? We're accommodating you. I'm going to be up, you know, from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock in the afternoon entertaining you. And there you can ask me not administrative things, not logistical things. There you can contact the institution. But maybe you want to say to me, you know, you did declare me competent. I just want to make certain I did it in that manner. Do you think that's a good manner, although I'm competent or whatever? Maybe you're not competent and maybe you're a little confused. There's things you want to ask of me in terms of the subject matter. I'm there for subject matter. Don't misunderstand this. I don't know the integral operations of this institution. There you've got to go today to the coordinator and her team. So then we can discuss it and have a time about it. If we are a lot of people, obviously I cannot listen in an open forum to everybody shouting at me. So I'm going to get a name list and my colleagues that's going to assist me if there's extra colleagues, I'm going to get a name list. And what we're going to do in a name list, the moment I get a name list, and if I'm not mistaken, there's going to be a date for shutdown of registration, which obviously is logical. So the moment the registration is shut down and we know that who is on the program, they're going to give me a name list. And I'm going to select leaders and deputy leaders, something I do with online training a lot. Otherwise, everybody shouts at the same time. You're going to be in a group. You can open your own group, forum, WhatsApp group, whatever you want to do. And then all the questions in these four open sessions you want to share with me will first go into the group, your own group, for these three months you're going to be busy with this. And there, the team leader, the deputy team leader, and your colleagues within your group alphabetically on the first letters of your surnames will try and answer your question. And if that cannot be done, when I go online, a team leader will come in and say, I'm from team so-and-so, and we've got five questions. I'll sit and we'll talk about it, and we'll move on to the next team. All right. And that's how we're going to operate it if there's over 300 people on the program, because we don't know. Some say 70, some say 90, some say 300. And depending on that, we have to control the communication. Otherwise, I'm sitting for 2 hours and I'm not really assisting or benefiting you at all. Okay, I've said that. I'm happy with that. I've now told you what to do there. And then, of course, go and look at the books that you have to access on your reading list. That is important. I've got a little bit of sinus, so don't worry about that. I'm just going to do this now and again. I'm sure we're all human. All right. I can take that much deeper, but then you don't want to listen to me. All right. Do the assignments. All right. That's about it. Now, if I remember something, Mrs. Rustoff, anything you think I should say? No, she's happy. So if I remember something while we're going through the code of conduct, and then I'll get back to it. All right. Okay, guys, I hope you're happy. I hope you're happy with these announcements. We're really trying to go out of our way to assist this group of aspirant advocates. And, of course, we want to be part and parcel of the solution and a great success rate in guys passing this. All right. Again, let me say this again. I said it in the first and second clip. Your exam questions will come out of the reading list. All right. And that, I'm just saying again, that's important to know. All right. So all the assignments we are setting up is on the reading list. The emphasis is on the reading list. All right. The guide is on the Legal Practice Act. The Legal Practice Act is paramount, to your reading list. All right. That's it. I'm happy to go on. I'm happy to go on. And as we remember things, then we'll just announce them. So whenever you see my name, you must look at those clips. It's not only about a subject matter, it's making the road easier for you. Now, we're going to be looking at a code of conduct for pupils. Now, there does not exist, first of all, a code of conduct for pupils. So they formulated the most important things for the code for pupils pertaining to the time that you're a pupil and acting in that capacity. So before you go any further, if you can put up a split screen, or if you have dual screens like my son in matric, don't know how he does that, you need to call up Ethics 2020 National Curriculum. Ethics 2020 National Curriculum. If you type it into the internet, it's immediately there. It's under the Code of Conduct. On the eLeader platform, you can get it there. But listening to me and making notes, electronic notes, or whether you're going to print it or not, I don't know, it's better you call that up. Now, why did they develop out of the official code of conduct, a code of conduct for pupils? Like I said, the laws changed tremendously. While you are a pupil, you can already act in court. There's a lot of things going up. You can get paid if the Bar Association agrees to something like this. There's discretion there. And if this is the situation, and even it is even said that in some instances, in some courts, you might be able to go there without your supervisor. And if that is the case, working on real cases for clients, obviously, we need to make certain now that as a pupil, within the ambit, the perimeters of being a pupil, there is some codes of the conduct that you take note of. Now, remember, liability is a funny thing. It can bite you in the ass. If you pass this program and we declare by a certificate you're competent, that means that you have listened to my clip, you know about this stuff, and you make a mock-up later in court, they can use this against you as being negligent. You have trained. Why didn't you do it right? So please, when we put up clips and we train on things like ethics, you must listen. All right. Now, there's a twofold approach to ethics I want to talk about here. And we just said that in a meeting also this morning. Everybody knows you must be honest, you mustn't steal, you mustn't murder. And a code of conduct and ethics is the same. They tell you these nature laws. Don't murder, don't kill, don't steal, all of those things. Nature laws, I call it, of the universe. We're all born and we grow up and we're supposed to know. That's the norm and trends of being a human on Earth. You shouldn't do those things. But then, there's another direction with the code of ethics. The complicated one. If I bring a specific application, I'm supposed to bring this under the attention of school. Those are not laws of the natural laws of the universe. Those are man-made wars on a day and age we're living in with legislation and what we are doing in 2020, 2021. And what I found in my career, and that has been quite disturbing to me, is the amount of people not reading the code of conduct. It's easy to say, I know, the code of conduct, honest, integrity, all of those nice things. But I don't know the specifics of specific things attached to rules, regulations, the act, etc., etc. Because they don't read the code of conduct. Senior advocates and attorneys that's never read through the code of conduct. Times has changed. Especially with this new Legal Practice Act, the promulgated regulations and rules out of it. And please, ladies and gentlemen, on another note, it seems that people think there's only one set of regulations under the Legal Practice Act. That's not true. Within the sections of the Legal Practice Act, the minister has the authority to promulgate regulations independently out of some of those sections. So when you look at the regulations promulgated for the purpose of Legal Practice Act, there's a few of them. And when you do your research, you must get hold of all of them. Just a side mention, I'm throwing that in. People think, oh, no, there's one set of regulations like with the National Credit Act, Consumer Protection. It's not a case for Legal Practice Act, all right? So that's important. All right, so you need to read. Now, when you look at the Ethics 2020 National Curriculum, the first thing they say in the introduction is, you need to know all the rules of the Code of Conduct. They say there in the beginning. This is one just emphasizing for pupils, and I'm about to start in a second or two. But they say there, don't think because we're only showing you this, you don't need to know the rest. That will quite correct, incorrect. So that is what we are looking at here, all right? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, respected future colleagues. I have a Red Bull here. I suppose I'm ready to grow wings. All right, let's go. There on the first page, or let me rather say the first paragraph, this curriculum is not numbered in page order. It's not only numbered in paragraph order. I'm not going to go through paragraph one with you. The important thing there for me to relate to you was, you know, to need to know the whole code, not just what I'm going to be discussing as fast as possible. I'm not going to waste your time. But unfortunately, there's a lot of court cases here. And before I go on, I have to say this now again. We have loaded between 2022 and 23 court cases for you. And we might load more later on. We might actually do that. And we're going to be discussing a few of them. But when you go into your code of conduct, you'll see the Ethics 2020 National Curriculum, and that will have a sub-tab. And in that sub-tab, there will be a great amount of court cases, all right? And all of these court cases, most of them, on the code of ethics is part and parcel of the reading list, all right? Maybe one or two that's not part of the reading list, but the subject matter is part of the reading list. So if you answer a question, you can always refer to it. Paragraph two, counsel's duty to court. That's the heading there. And before I even get into it, there's a culture. Because I'm an advocate of the High Supreme Court, going to become an advocate of the High Supreme Court, obviously, that's my house, and I'm proud of it. And I don't act like a fool, somebody that's unmannered or barbarian within my house. Within my own house, within my own space, there I want things to go well and correct. And it's in this house that I want to build my career. So counsel's duty to the court is your house. It's your place. Doesn't matter whether it's a MAC court, equality court, high court. And remember, Supreme Court and Superior Court is not the same. Those are different courts under different acts. Any court literally for an advocate, specifically for an advocate, this is his house. Because advocates, other than other legal practitioners, make their living in their house, in their court. And this is how your mind thought process must shift now. When you're listening to my voice in your house, I'm ever emphasizing it. That's your house. And in your house, you've got good manners. For example, you will never walk into court if you don't go and meet the adjudicator on the bench of that specific court you're going to appear in. It's your house. And you have a duty to the house to make certain that everything there goes legally, goes orderly. There's no anarchy, influence, or chaos. And you also, in your house, has to contribute if you see something going wrong. Or one of your colleagues, your family members in your house doing something wrong. You have to report it. A lot of people, oh, I'm not going to report anybody. You've got to clean your house out when you need to clean your house out. This is where we as advocates make a living. And therefore, you will see under these court cases, it's actually shocking under these court cases how many advocates were reported in order for other advocates to clean the house they are proud of. All right, guys, so let us sift in a little bit. It's my house, and I want a clean house, and I want an orderly house. And that's why I have a duty to my house, such being the court. The first one we're going to talk about is the duty to act honestly and not to mislead the court. Boy, oh boy. I've sat in court and I could clearly hear that this advocate, I cannot prove it, but I can hear, I can observe in his demeanor. He's now talking a lot of nonsense. A lot of nonsense. And I think, I don't know, in the first or second clip, I spoke about this advocate in front of Jas Bertelsmann. I recall saying something about that, I hope. Where Jas Bertelsmann was the judge on a case, he was quoting it totally wrong. He was misleading the judge. And he can be happy. Well, I don't know. Maybe he was even reported after when Jas Bertelsmann's a good judge. He won't be toiled with. All right. So honesty is paramount. Honesty means you do not fabricate at all a case for your client. You do not over-exaggerate. You do not lie for your client. And you will see in the court cases here, if you go and read them all, if you are caught and you are reported, you're in serious trouble. And some of that trouble can amount to criminal charges being brought against you. Advocates has to be honest. Honest to the clients in terms of the prospects, etc., etc. And advocates must never be drawn in by their own actions or the action of an instructing attorney to fabricate or to lie in any way, not even on the facts of the case, but to mislead the court. All right, now the first court case I want to take you there is the General Counsel of the Bar versus Matthijs 2005 SAE. And I'm just going to mention the cases and quickly tell you in 2-3 sentences what I were about so you can get an idea what this is about. What happened here is he was up for misconduct on the foundation of misleading the court. Another aspect he was up for was not returning the deposit of a clashing brief. So he had multiple briefs, but he took multiple briefs and they clashed. Another word for clash, in my opinion, is conflict of interest. And that was one of the reasons that he was in court. Now, we know we mustn't steal, we mustn't murder, but this is different. This is man-made rules to keep your house clean. And this is things we don't know if you don't look at it. You mustn't involve yourself with things like this. If you have any case where you have a conflict of interest, you must walk away. And the General Counsel of Bar versus Matthijs case is a good case of that. Another case I want to draw your attention just quickly. I'm just going to go quickly through them. Kate Kana versus Society of Advocates of South Africa. This was a blatant, ongoing ignoring of the rules of court. Apparently, it was reported a couple of times. The rules of court of all the different courts, our houses we work in, is important. This is how we put your cases forward in an orderly manner. This is how we uphold fundamental rights within the Constitution, stepping away from what is fair, unfair, legal and illegal. And in this case, this specific individual was accosted on the foundation of blatantly ignoring the rules and was evidently suspended. Let me take you to the Society of Advocates of Natal. And Natal Law Society versus Merit in 1997. Another case where an attorney misled the court and a strike-off was ordered. And this case went a step further. It was a divorce case. When they were finished with this case, the court made it very clear that the standards of conduct is the same for attorneys and advocates. There's no difference. When we talk about honesty, how do we put it apart and say, well, attorney can be so honest, but an advocate, this is the level of honesty we want. It's impossible. And in this specific court case, they say, I don't care whether you're an attorney or an advocate, the standards of conduct must be the same, and there's no differentiation between the two. So in case you were wondering what the situation is with that, that made it very clear. And then they accosted an advocate there. They accosted the attorney there, and they dealt with them. All right? So there's a couple of court cases that deals with. Let's go back to it. Let's have a look at it if we break it up. It deals with counsel's duty to the court specifically, the duty to act honestly and not to mislead a court. There's one thing that really beefs me. That is when I'm up against an opponent and I can hear he's exaggerating. I cross-examined a woman who was badly assaulted. I defended her boyfriend years ago in the magistrate's court in Pretoria. And at the end of the day, she over-exaggerated the testimony. In a cross-examination, I ripped her apart to such an extent that I called in a medical doctor that backed up what I thought was true in terms of substantiation of under cross-examination, saying that she over-exaggerated. It was never as bad as, although such a thing should not happen, never misunderstand me, it was never as bad as she said it was. Over-exaggeration is misleading. She was misleading the court. And we cannot do that. Not even a state prosecutor can do that. Now, I never had a feeling that a state prosecutor was involved in this. I actually picked up she was over-exaggerating in affidavits when I had discovery of the police docket. But it's the same. Things like that should not happen in court. All right. Going on to the next one there. Duty and ex parte applications to act with utmost good faith and to disclose material facts which might influence the court. Ex parte applications in their nature are dangerous because we're not filing it on opposition. Your application to become an advocate is an ex parte application. And therefore, you must disclose all material facts to that application. Any ex parte application has got ingredients of danger to it. There's nobody that can jump and say, oh, all right, no, that's not correct. You're there alone. And therefore, the duty in ex parte application to act with utmost good faith and to disclose material facts which might influence the court is imperative. If you found out later, there's a lot of things that can happen to you. One I'm thinking of is perjury. Because remember, you bring an ex parte application under application procedure, which means all your affidavits are under oath. It's imperative that you look at those things. I want to quickly mention two cases there. Estate Logie versus Priest case in 1926, where they did not, in an ex parte application, disclose the material facts. And the material facts in this case was a settlement agreement. It's imperative. You cannot bring an ex parte application on the foundation of a settlement agreement and not mention it, because the content of a settlement agreement constitutes what? Multiple parties. I can't have a settlement agreement with myself. Maybe in different capacities, but not with myself as an individual. Court was very unhappy with that. And they said that that legal practitioner did not condone to the code of disclosing the material facts, and they were trouble. Another case, there's Hassan and another versus Berange Nomio Officio of 2012. Now, Nomio Officio means usually you're dealing with like a trust. N-O, capitals N-O, will also always mean nomio officio. Very same thing. Ex parte application, non-disclosure of material facts that a court felt was desirous to be in that application, and those practitioners were accosted. Got into trouble. Misconduct, code of conduct. Can be suspended, can be struck off the roll. There's so many things that can happen to you. Another one we need to look at this afternoon, as I'm sitting here, don't know when you're listening to this, is duty to direct the court's attention to relevant and adverse authorities. Oh boy. Let me read it again. Duty to direct the court's attention to relevant and adverse authorities. What is an authority? It is case authority. court cases. That's when I walk into court and I bring an application. The rule actually says that if there is a stare decisis court authority, stare decisis court authority, that's against my case in terms of what I'm arguing, I'm under obligation to tell the court about that case. Yeah, I know, it sounds funny. Why would you do it to the detriment of your client? We have to. If for no other reason than what for at all, it's in the interest of justice as well as the public interest. Not to do it, just acting contra bonus mores. We have to do it. We have to bring our case and say, I will bring the attention of the court in that case that has authority, and it says something else. So the court can make up its own mind. It doesn't matter when you defend the client, and I know people don't understand it. But before we even there, we are officers of the court, and we have to stick with the interest of justice. We cannot mislead, and if I know about another case that is contradicted to what I'm arguing, it is misleading not to tell the court. I know it doesn't make sense to a lot of people. But legal practitioners foremost stands for the public interest and for the public interest of justice, for bettering justice, for putting it in front of the court that's fair and that a fair verdict can be rendered. I know, things like that's like, why, you crazy? I'm not going to do that. You're going to get into trouble if you don't do it. And believe me, your attorney of record is going to be upset with you. You're going to do it. You have to do it. She said, why don't you say it? It's because we lost. If you kept your mouth shut, we would have lost. Don't listen to those influences. All right? So that's very important to me to bring that on your attention. The court case there I'm referring you to is Ulde versus Minister of Home Affairs and another in 2008. They misled a court. There was contradictory authority. And there was evidence, remember this, that they knew about it. They ignored it. And the court says, well, that's negligent. That's negligent. Now, I just want to say something about ignoring and negligent. Maybe the way I said it was not totally correct. Negligent usually have to do with the fact if you are a counsel of certain seniority and you're supposed to know about it, if you did the research, you would have found it. And it's well known. You'll be in for misconduct. That's negligent. Blatantly ignorant of it while you know about it, that's different. Some people, some judges even go forward and say, well, that's fraud. We can take that to a criminal extent. We can take that to a damages claim. So ignorant and negligence are not necessarily always the same thing. Negligence, you ought to have known about, everybody knows about it. Ignorant is you knew about it, but you didn't use it. You misled the court. And that can branch out into criminal activity. So guys, it's very important that a duty to direct the court's attention to relevant adverse authority is important. This is one of the reasons why I, as an advocate all the years, in motion courts, it's fine, you'll jump up and you argue and all of those things. But when I have trials, criminal trials, any trials of whatever sort in civil court, I always put up heads of arguments. Doesn't matter where I am. Sometimes my mitigation, if I've lost but I'm mitigating on the sentence, some of those heads of arguments I set up sometimes would be over 200 pages long. I do my work. And when I do my research, I usually find these court cases. Please, guys, don't be caught in this rut where you should have known it or they can prove you knew about it and didn't use it. That is then also misleading the court on account of adverse authorities. The next one I want to talk to you about is duty to draw the court's attention to deviation from standard forms and orders. I'll read it again. A little bit of a complicated one, isn't it? But if you listened, you already know this is how we operate in court. Duty to draw the court's attention to deviation from standard forms and orders. And I want to deal with one court case there. It's Ex parte Satbel of 1984. There's a duty on advocates to draw the court's attentions to any deviations, repetitions, and duplications from the normal standard of forms and orders and process through which we operate in court. So if there's a specific way we operate in court, and in this specific court case, there was a major duplications of affidavits. And the court took exception to this, and it was based on cost too, the fees we charge. So they went beyond the rules, beyond what is normal, beyond the normal way of doing things through the court, the forms and orders. And they did it in such a manner that I never brought it specifically under the attention of the court. Did you even know about this? How many advocates and attorneys do you think know about this? The end of the court retaliated and said, but there's a code of conduct on this. There's a duty to draw the court's attention to deviation from the forms that you do, and the guys didn't do it. And they were in trouble. Go read Ex parte Sadbel, and you'll know. You'll see what happened there. Now, quickly, I want to insert a statement here. When we give you court cases to read, and on the reading list too, this is very important. This is kind of an announcement in the middle of this, but I'm sure that maybe Mrs. Rustoff will bring it out somewhere in an introduction letter or somewhere else. Is when we cite a court case, look at what we're saying. Are we citing the court case only as the court case? Then you have to read the whole court case. But if we cite a court case and at the end of the court case, we say at par, para, or paras, 7, 8, 9, then we mean you must only go and read those paragraphs, and they're usually very short. I want to bring this on your attention because your time is limited up to September. Look at your citation of a court case. If we at the end say only read the paragraphs, only go and read the paragraphs. But we, if we don't say at paras or par or para, then you have to read the whole court case. Just helping you there a little bit, all right? A lot of these things are linked to paragraphs. The next one I want to bring onto your attention is the duty to present the best argument available to the litigant. Guys, stay away from alcohol. Don't go and drink with your buddies if you have to be in court tomorrow. Don't go and socialize with the clients and rock up their babalas. And your plan was the previous night to put up your heads of argument, but the socializing went up until 2 o'clock the morning, and you fall in there and you're shooting like a gunslinger cowboy out of the heap. Yeah, I had to do that in my time, not because of the abuse of alcohol, because sometimes you find yourself in that position, then you throw. And if you win it, you actually feel good. But no, guys, you have to present the best argument possible. And this is a very interesting one, because you get people that puts up heads of argument and they just rush it. You are getting paid for this. You cannot rush it. And that's why the one part of this pupil program and for you as an advocate is legal research and legal opinion. You need to know how to chronologically set out the heads of argument and argument the strongest case you can possibly argue for your client. And believe me, I have adjudicated privately. I've been on the bench privately. And I've listened to people on the labor law within corporations, and I know this was not prepared. There was no effort here. And when that happened, you will not believe it. If you don't do this correctly, there's a code of conduct. It can be misconduct. You can be up for misconduct, and you can get into serious trouble if you don't present the best possible argument. And the only way you can present the best possible argument if you do your legal research, you lock down your chamber, and you work your hours, and you make certain that when you stand up and you walk away from your table, within your soul, you know, you feel comfortable, you've done everything humanly possible to benefit your client who is paying you for your services. I've seen this so many times. And then a frustration on the judge's face. Must I report him or not? Because everybody can see he's getting paid to do this, but I don't know where he was. He didn't do his work. Not going to go on with that. That's actually one of the logical ones. You're getting paid. You've got to do your work to the best of your ability. I take pride in my work, but I also take pride in the print of my work. Is it decent? Have I chosen the right font, size, space setting? I take pride in it. Because remember, your heads of argument goes up to the bench. It goes to your opposing counsel. They are looking at this stuff. What are they thinking about you? You're a total idiot. Remember, you're becoming an advocate. And this is part and parcel of what an advocate is all about. Heads of argument. All right. Enough of that. Let's go on to 2.6. That's the next one. Duty to preserve and uphold the dignity of the courts and officers of the court. There's a silver and a trump case. You can go and read those there. Be careful with this. Be careful what you say to courts, how you act in courts, how you talk to court officers, from the register to the judge in court. You must always endeavor to preserve and uphold the dignity of the courts and officers. We're not always happy, are we? Before all the building rubble, register is rude, the prosecutor is rude. And clearly the judge on the bench doesn't want to be there in that specific day. No. What I do, and I can try and teach you something, is I totally steamroll over all of that. I become deaf and blind to these external factors working on to me to make me negative and impact negatively on my standard of service delivery to my client, who is usually, not always, but usually, the attorney of record. Because there's another court case out that says the client is also your client. And there's a court case out that says, you know, this is new. You can sue that client directly also if you don't get paid instead of suing the attorney. And I want to go too deep in that. That's new on the block. Rather than walking around and grumbling and becoming part of the negative problem, be positive. Always positive. Guys, I cannot say that too much. When I've got a prosecutor that's rude with me, I talk over him. I talk over with him. I stay in his space. And eventually he breaks down and becomes a human again. That's what it's all about. When I have a judge and I can see I'm in trial and I've got problems with this judge, I make certain that I spend time in his office and greeting him. I'm civil to him. I'm civil to him in the hallways. I'm civil to him in court when I talk to him, regardless of his behavior and demeanor. And eventually he comes around. Not to influence the outcome of the case. No, 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 no. But to reach that dignity of the court and its officers. I personally do believe that officers of the court break down their own dignity in the way they behave. I'm always, when I go there, already prepared to deal with this negativity, and I'm already energized to change it by my presence and the way I talk and the way I'm bland to ease whatever. Let's go on. Do not abuse the process of the court. Phew. You can actually go to jail for this. I've seen people change court orders. Judge on the bench says, all right, here's the court order. Attorney says to the counsel, can we get a file? And he runs down to the typist. And on his way there, he takes a pen and changes the court order. One letter. Or maybe he changes and to or. It's one example. Then these people we report go to jail. Or they get struck off the roll. Do not abuse the process of the court. Playing games with litigation. Because you're making money. Filing all these notices, that's not really relevant. Bringing in criminal calls, all these arguments, that's not really relevant for postponements. Don't muck around with the court process. Go there, get it done to the best of your ability as soon as possible, because you're getting paid to do it and our fees are high. Depending on your seniority, people pay you a lot of money to do what we do. Stay away from that. In that regard, you can go and read the Code of Conduct 60 more in depth. 2.8 applications for recusal of presiding officers. I'll tell a story now. I had a few of them in my life, but one was very heavy. I want to refer you there to the court case of President of the Republic of South Africa and others versus South African Rugby Football Union and others 1998. The whole idea about recusing people, the objective, if you go and read this court case, is the onus, first of all, is on the applicant to bring this application and to prove, the onus to prove that we have a biased presider, adjudicator, is on the onus of the applicant. But the bottom line about such application is we must prove that this adjudicator is of an impartial mind, thus not of a partial mind. That's what, if you read this court case, you'll see that's the test, and I agree with it. A rude judge is not biased. An unpleasant judge is not biased. That's got no proof whatsoever. Maybe it's just the way it is. In his office, he's usually friendly. When he gets on the bench, something happens. Comes a rude person. That doesn't make him biased. You haven't liked this guy for years. Maybe you were advocates together. He's a judge now. You just don't like him. You hate him. And now he's biased. That can never be. This is the test. The test of an impartial mind. And then you have to prove it. There's stuff that he has to do. Now, here's my story. Years ago, I did a big criminal case. It lasted me 3 years. It was in the newspapers. Not going to say what case it was. We started at the Bella Bella, and then it was transferred over to Modimolle. And for 3 years, we fought it. Criminal case, attempted murder and kidnapping. I was representing, obviously, the accused. I had a very good attorney of record. I really appreciated him. Every time we went to court, he will pick me up and we'll go together. We were a team. Advocate was not more important than an attorney or whatever. No titles, we were a team. And we knew we were fighting for a guy that was a political issue. And that he was innocent. That made us even fight very hard. And when the state advocate, nowadays a friend of mine, we later on shook hands because it was an ugly business. For 3 years, it was hell. I think we brought more applications against each other, me and the state advocate, that work on the case at hand and cross the witnesses and cross examination. We were at each other's throat every 2 seconds. It was a gigantic, unpleasant battle for 3 years. At one stage, the state advocate decided, well, the magistrate is biased. And there was no way he was biased. He ruled against me as much as I ruled against him. But the reason he said that the magistrate was biased is he said that while he was questioning witnesses, we would slam our chairs on the floor. Which was true, but not true to trying to impact on him. The court we were sitting in, right behind below our chairs, live wires were running. So every time we jumped up and sit down as we're doing our thing, you never know if you're going to get shocked, falling over the building rubble in courts there in Modimolle. That was one of the reasons why we'd shift around. And then he said, yeah, we're trying to distract him. He brought an application, so the whole thing was stopped. The magistrate said, right, step down. I'll see you in half an hour, and you will present arguments, whether I'm now biased or not. So we went off to the Kentucky or the Wimpy somewhere, I can't remember, and I sat down. And luckily that day, I had all my books with me. One of them was Curry and Duval. And they ordered us food, but we only had 50 minutes. What are you going to eat? I worked out my argument, and I was very surprised at the effectiveness of Curry and Duval, Constitutional Bill of Rights. Went back, and a fight started. I couldn't talk 2 days afterwards, so verbal I became. State advocate up first, he brings his argument. I up, then he, then me, and so it goes on. And at the end of the day, the adjudicator ruled that he was not biased, he's staying on the bench, which I respected a lot. And it was not then taken any further by the state advocate. Eventually, we won that court case. But there's one thing I was very sure of. The adjudicator did not have an impartial mind. He benefited the state as much as he benefited the defense. And this was just a tactic. What did we say? What did we say? Do not abuse the process of court. A tactic from the state advocate to put him under pressure. Whether he recused himself or not, to put him under pressure to benefit the state in the event he recused himself not much better than he did. I mean, the state lost the case, a big political case. They wanted to bring an appeal, which they never did. So that is what that's about. Before you say something like that, make double certain that you know what you're doing. Because at the end of the day, it can be abuse of the process of court. And that is what it was. Okay, there's a story for you can relate to. Hopefully when you're an advocate, you'll get into these fights. We saw Christmas coming. We saw the Curry Cup coming. We saw the soccer coming. And then next year we're back. All right. But a good case for advocate. I was paid well. I did my work well. And at the end of the day, as a team, I didn't win that case. That's bullshit. As a team, me and that attorney, we won that case. As a team, be careful for this title on the shoulder thing. We see it every day we work, people walking around with that. Look at me. I was a judge, or I am a judge, or I'm an advocate. Don't go there. All right, I'm going to go on. Principles governing the hopeless case. This is very important. Principles of the governing the hopeless case. I'm not going to talk too much about it, but to say that you cannot take a hopeless case on. You cannot take payment for a hopeless case. Maybe that first consultation fee is. But if it's a case hopeless, you've got to tell him it's hopeless. You cannot say, oh, I'm going to make 100,000 rand out of these idiots. You cannot do that. Here, I've asked you in your third and fourth multi-choice questions on the reading list out of Owen Rogers. I've asked you a lot of questions on this. I've tested you thoroughly on this because I've seen this too many times. You have in divorce cases, and I saw it last night again, a case came into my chambers where you can see it's hatred. And hatred is now pushing people to make cases against the ex-wife. And when I said, but how are you going to do that? Both parents are living. How are you going to sue one for maintenance? They say, yeah, but the one parent says I have to do that. They say, but whoa, stop the bus. You don't know what you're talking about. It's a hopeless case. It's a hopeless case. You're wasting my time. This comes from a bad place. It comes from a dark place. It comes from a hate place. Get out of my chambers. I'm not listening to this. It's a hopeless case. And I'm not even going to force them to pay me my consultation fee. Just want them out of there. It's a hopeless case. It comes from a bad place. You cannot do a hopeless case. If you do a hopeless case, there's many bad cost orders that can be awarded against you. There I want you to tell, go, don't. Now, Owen Rogers says, the reading list says you must read the whole thing, but you must pay attention to pages 1551, if I recollect correctly. No. Are you listening to me? You read the whole thing. All right? But in any event, I'm forcing you to do it because otherwise you won't be able to answer 03 and 04 multi-choice questions. All right, I'm going on, ladies and gentlemen. Are we having fun or what? Red Bull, eh? Red Bull. All right. Okay. Principles governing the hopeless case. Then we're moving on to paragraph 3, counsel's duty to clients. They talk about a cap rank rule. Now, you must go and read all of it. But a cap rank rule specifically deals with accepting and declining briefs. All right? So the only thing I actually want to say is be very careful. Under what circumstances you can decline a brief? What do you specialize in? Why are you declining? What is this all about? And be very careful when you accept briefs. Is this against people that's in business with you? Family members, whatever the situation is, the cap rank rule is a couple of clauses there you can go through. I'm not going to say anything more about that. Just make certain that if you are too close to something, and in my advocate's career, I've always said to me, this sounds like conflict of interest. Let me give you an example. I work very closely with this people's program. So my name is all over this thing. My boss is Michelle Beeston, and then another boss is sitting here beside me because she's my boss when it comes to quality and assurance. I'm working in a team. And the other day, the LPC sent a notice out for your guys who's going to mark your exams, and they invited people in that I think is more than 6 or 7 years experience. I was tempted, but I cannot do it because I feel conflict of interest. I have nothing to do with setting up your exam. So there is no conflict of interest. I just feel there is. I'm just too close of it. And I said, no, I'm not going to do this. It doesn't seem right. And this is what I'm trying to teach you. When you have that inclination, this is conflict of interest, don't accept that brief. But remember, you can be forced to accept the brief, either by the LPC or by the committee that's doing the misconduct on you. You are not allowed to just decline a brief as an advocate. So please go and look at those things. All right, under counsel's duty to his clients, and I take this very seriously. My client pays my car, he pays my house, he puts my child through school, he puts the food on my table. He's important to me, even if he's a pompous ass, I don't know. He's important to me, and I always treat him with respect. Doesn't matter his characteristic and what does he think of himself. I respect him. And nowadays, the attorney and the client is my client. You can go read those court cases. So I take this very seriously. This is the person that's going to feed me, cloth me, build my career with his money power. So this is something that's important to me. The duty to further client's case, the duty to further clients fearlessly to the best of counsel's ability. Guys, you cannot become an advocate if you're going to be an advocate fighting in court and you have fear in you. You can't. You must be have a strong personality. You must be strong of character to be able to be an advocate in court. Because we don't take each other's nonsense. We argue with the judge on a respectful foundation, but we argue with him. If you are fearless of what to say, and you are fear I'm going to hurt my colleague's feelings, and a lady is going to be mad at me, and he finds me in a bar, he's going to slap me around, don't become an advocate. Advocates are fearless, but respectful. They're not afraid to take their friends on, because one thing about advocates, you're fighting against a co-counsel that's your drinking buddy. Unfortunately, it happens all the day in the High Court. So you cannot stop it, you're sitting in the chambers. And that's just the way it is. And I've seen people get super upset with each other. But I saw something one day. It was very interesting. I was a pupil. And my junior master advocate, Linda Pretoria, is a very good advocate. I have a tremendous amount of respect for her. And she was my junior master. And I only wish her the best. I wish she has a blessed life, blessed career. And she was in court one day. And I was there as the pupil with her. And she was bringing this application against a male advocate, which obviously he's there on your floor and he's well-known and friend. And she gave it to him. And he gave it to her. And she gave it back to him, respectfully. And he lost. But he was was much more senior than her. So when we walked out of the chamber, we came out of different doors. The court has got different doors to go in and out. And we came out of this door, and he came out of this door, hurrying up to another court, and we literally ran into each other, and they laughed. And I remember him saying to her, you know, you can win them all. And I thought, wow, they just had that gigantic clash of the titans in court. And outside court, it was left in court. All right? So you got to be fearless as a counsel. I've gone up against friends of mine. I won't be friends with me anymore afterwards. I've been in one criminal case, which went on for 2 years, that the two first prosecutors walked out of court and said, not fighting against this guy. I brought in a third one. Luckily, he stuck around, and that's how we finished off. Just say, no. We liked him. We don't like him anymore. So you've got to be fearless, but respectful. All right, going on. You have selected to begin an advocate. It calls for internal strength. You got to stand up. You got to say what needs to be said. And if you have a problematic judge up there with respect, you got to deal with him. That needs fearlessness. All right, let's go on. I'm going now to paragraph 3.3. And in a few seconds, I might shift out of view, turn my back on you, so the sinus doesn't get a bit of me. But we're not going to stop the recording. We're all human. And it's winter. Very well, 3.3, we'll deal with that quickly. Maintaining confidentiality and legal professional privilege. Legal advice privilege and litigation privilege. Okay, you remember me turning my back on you? I got to go now. We'll be back in a second. Okay. I'm back, guys. Here we are. It's just a little bit of sinus. This winter is getting to all of us. I'm sure a lot of you sitting there listening to me also have a stack of tissues with you. And we're just human, aren't we? Right. This is interesting. A lot of people don't know there's a difference between legal advice privilege and litigation privilege. Can you believe that? Did you know that? There's so many people who don't know that. The legal advice privilege is what we are saying to the attorney and advocate in consultations. And you all know that one, right? Yes. Did you know there is litigation privilege? Yes. And it has to do with who does the litigation privilege belongs to? Litigation privilege belongs to the litigant, not the witnesses, specifically when it pertains to statements. And you can go and read Competition Commission of South Africa versus Arco Law Mittal South Africa Limited and others in 2013. When a witness has made a statement in litigation and in the litigation process, that content of that statement of the witness, that privilege belongs to the litigant, not a witness. And if you walk around and throw these things abroad, you can get into trouble. That's the privilege. And I'm sure I'm teaching a couple of you something you never knew. Because everybody knows about the normal privilege. But you say to what is litigation privilege? No, but that's the normal privilege. No. And it's important to understand here that a litigant can use that privilege as he deems fit. And a witness has nothing to say again about it while we are in litigation. From the beginning of litigation to the end of litigation. Litigation privilege. So please, guys, here I want to talk to you about privilege. Now, in the advocates chambers, there's a rule. If we go into the bar there, or shouldn't call it the bar, place where we socialize. I'm not in the bars anymore, but I was. I'm an independent advocate now. And everything that says there, said there, stays there. That's important. I have taught for many years on the sideline, and I've sat at social events so many times, and I hear a colleague bragging about a case, mentioning a name, and I think by myself, wow, sir, if that gets to the wrong ears, you can be sued, and you can be up for misconduct. Advocates, I've said in clip one, recording number one is lone wolves. Because they work after closed doors, spend a lot of time in your chambers alone. But you're also solitary creatures, because you need to keep everything to yourself. I don't go home and say to my wife, this and this has happened. Okay, taken into regard that for the last couple of years, she has been an administrator in my chambers. But I've got ladies sitting there. I've got contract ladies that come in for 2 or 3 days, hours a day, and they work there and they hear things. I make them sign indemnifications. I had somebody in this week, that sat there and worked on stuff for me for a couple of hours a day, paying them per hour. But first they sign indemnification, because what happens in my office is privileged. And when I socialize, I don't talk about my cases. And that's why alcohol is a bad thing, because it loosens the tongue. And the title advocate can also be a bad thing, because I want to talk about what I've achieved. You can talk about it. Don't mention names. Don't mention specifics. You can get into serious trouble. So this is something I know you didn't know. There's a difference between legal advice privilege and litigation privilege. Going on to paragraph 3.4, conflict of interest between clients. I've had that a lot. If you defend two accused and suddenly there's a problem between you and one of them, they don't agree with what's going on, and they have to, and they maybe change, or they are implicating the other client, right? Let's rather use that. Then you've got to say, well, I've got to stop this. I've got to now pick one. But now you have a problem. You should actually recuse yourself. Why? And this is something I found a lot in criminal cases. You've already had 2 or 3 consultations with them. That means you know a lot about the other person's defense. And he might turn state witness. What then? You know everything. What are you going to do? It's conflict of interest. So conflict of interest between clients is important. You can go look at Hollenbach and Ex parte Swain, the cases there. But when you have the feeling, the inclination of conflict of interest, I made this out many years ago with myself. If I feel uncomfortable, I'm walking. That's been a good thing for me. There's always been enough work to sustain me. So that is important. Be careful of that. Conflict of interest between counsel and clients and presiding officers and opponents. I also want you to be careful of that. Family members, friends. Maybe you have a business and you've got a partner there. Conflict of interest between counsel and clients and presiding officers, opponents. Maybe the judge is your brother or your brother-in-law. I don't know. Get out of there. Ask them to stand it down, to transfer it over to another court, or ask him to recuse himself on account of this. He'll do it. He'll do it. But ladies and gentlemen, I don't care how fair that trial is. The losing side, on account of you not doing this, has a total attack that will succeed. Just because he was your brother, regardless of the fact of whether that was the best fair trial you've ever experienced in your life. Get out of there, make a plan. Don't let it slide. I remember one day, my surname is Clark, without an E after the K, and I met a guy and I really knew his family, but I've never met him before in my life. And he was in a divorce and I represented him, and the first thing he just asked me, hey, is this guy brother or what? I said, no, he must be. I told the judge, he must be. He has the features in his face, everything. You can see he's a clerk. But I have never ever in my life seen him before. But the judge sits back and he says, no, you're an advocate. When you tell me something in court, I'm supposed to believe you, and I can see nothing in not believing you, and he allowed it. And I divorced the guy. I was lucky. I really didn't know him. But we knew we were family somewhere along the line. So be careful of this, eh? Be careful of this. And when a judge asked me, I didn't say, no, 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 it's another clerk. I said, no, I also think he's family. The guys who look like the lot of us. And so I don't know. I didn't beat around the bush. If the judge did say to me, no, I don't want you to do this, I would say, I appreciate it. I respect it. I'm walking. All right. So be careful with that, eh? Paragraph 3.6, we're looking at counsel's independence in conducting matters. I want to refer you there to R versus Matonzi of 1958. And it has to do with the withdrawal of advocates when clients are difficult. Clients' independence in conducting matters. Now, this court case specifically had to do with the fact that when you walk into court, you can understand the attorney is in control of a court case until you go into the High Supreme Court. I always used to say, the moment you go through the bat wings into the High Court, then he must keep his trap shut. End of the story. Because this is your house, you're going to fight. And if he's yapping here, not agreeing with you, it's a problem. That's why I always aligned myself with attorneys in which I can operate as a team. And there is understanding between us and we have respect between us. But what happened here was interesting. This advocate said, we're going to do this like that. He walked into court before it. And the client started fighting the advocate, not agreeing, not wanting to testify. And you're going to go and read this case. At the end of the day, this advocate says, this client is making it impossible for me to do my work. I cannot defend him. He's not taking my advice at all. And that is how, then, in terms of counsel's independence conducting matters, advocate says, I'm standing back. The heck with this. Go and read R versus Matonzi. And you'll see the foundation for that. Guys, you cannot keep a client because he's your bread and butter, but he's obstructing you. Happens a lot. I quite get aggressive about that kind of things. I'm sorry. What did you say to me? Yeah, but do you understand what you're saying? I say we have to do this. No, I'm sorry. If that is how you're going to be, I'm withdrawing. And then I notulate it. And if it happens in open court, I stand up and say, all right, we're all familiar with the Code of Conduct 3.9, 9.9. This is what's happening. Therefore, I'm recusing myself. I'm very technical. You've got to cover yourself. Otherwise, there's always a comeback. And you're an advocate now. You've got to be streetwise, an independent figure, and you've got the best footwork. There has to be in a difficult, critical situation. Footwork must be very good. If you have a problem with not so good footwork, go and look the old movie Footloose. My old pick you up there. I'm trying to be funny. Mrs. Rustoff, am I succeeding? She's laughing, but not nodding her head. I don't know. I hope you're laughing. At least I'm laughing. All right, let's go on, man. This is fun stuff. I enjoy doing this. Why do I enjoy doing this? I'm saying that we're a bunch of honest guys. It's a pity that in the day and age we're living in, we've got to say that to each other, teach that to each other. What has become of man? Aren't we supposed by birthright to be honest? Now we've got to say to each other, you must be honest. What has gone wrong? Isn't that something to think about, eh? But I enjoy doing this because this is our house. And I like my house. I did very well in all my houses as a practicing advocate. And I have respect for all my house. Even the guys that wasn't pleasant, I have respect for them. Because if I don't allow them to get me down, I grow. All right, let's go on. Enough of that psychology, isn't that right? But then advocates and attorneys are the best psychologists around. I mean, you do a divorce case. I've done many of them when I was a junior counsel. You have to be a psychiatrist or something, because it's tears and tissues, and you've got to work with it. You've got to care about people. Maybe it's a good time to say something now about that. I don't think you can be a good advocate if you don't care about people. I would never forget in one case I did, I had the accused on a cross-examination for 2-3 days. She became sick. I crossed her. Man, there's nothing. And at one stage, she shouted at me in court that, why are you attacking me? What do you have against me? Immediately, I stood back and I said, absolutely nothing. I think you're a wonderful person. But I had her in there for 3 days. Can you imagine how your tummy is running? You can't sleep at night because this guy's on your back, cross-examining you for 3 days in criminal court. And the magistrate, very good magistrate, black magistrate from Pretoria, a wonderful magistrate. He was the court administrator there. He's what a good magistrate. He turned to him and he says, no, calm down. The advocate is only doing his work. If he oversteps his boundaries, I will set him straight. So that's what I'm thinking about when I talk to you about having respect for people, and even if they're not nice, to later on not take that too personally. Advocates has to be good people. The day I brought the closing argument, she was sitting in the back there, totally white in the face. I walked up to her and says, I'm going to make 3 hours of representations in this court against you today, because I'm defending the accused. She was the complainant. And I said, please, I'm going to say things that is factual, that I believe in, but I want you to understand, it's not personal. I am the accused, for the advocate for the accused. This is my work. And apparently, they took her out of court as I went on and get too deep into what I had to say there for my client, attacking her, of course. Now. And then 2 months later, I ran into her in a discim shop. I saw and I thought, oh, she's going to throw me with a toaster. She ran up to me, gave me a hug and said, if I ever need an advocate, it's going to be you. So be a good person. Be a good person. It works for you. I'll never forget that. I don't want to mention her name and so on, but that was just amazing. And you can bring this kind of thing upon yourself. To be an advocate, you have to have a soul. And unfortunately, I say this with a heavy heart, a lot of my colleagues, I think, has lost theirs along the road. And I'm not saying that because I think it. It's because they've said it to me. And then this code of conduct becomes problematic. If you feel after years of practice becoming negative and things are not working, then you start violating this code of conduct. So I'm not just telling you a story to be funny. I'm trying to show you something. These are important stuff. You've got to be fearless. You've got to be aggressive. But you've got to be a good person. Otherwise, I personally don't think you're going to be a good advocate. All right. Let's go on. I've got all the time in the world. We can sit here the whole night. I wonder how Mrs. Rustoff is feeling about that. Admissions and undertakings made and settlement concluded by counsel on behalf of the clients. There at 3.7, you can go and look at Hawks versus Hawk and another. Advocate with no mandate, failure of advocate under that situation. And then, of course, you have a failure of justice. If you are not a trust-bearing advocate, don't take clients from the street. That's what I want to say. Now, understand what's happening here. This advocate didn't have an instructing attorney in Hawks versus Hawks and another, which is illegal. He went through the court case. He made many undertakings, if I correct, collecting adult case in terms of immovable property. And when they found out that he had no legal standing, the whole case and all the undertakings had no credibility. It was illegal. And they had a total failure of justice. He was in trouble. If you are not a trust-bearing advocate, you need instructions either from an attorney, or a trust-bearing advocate can instruct you to, or according to the regulations and the act sections in the Legal Practice Act from law clinics or juristic persons, etc., as defined in the Act. Don't play games. You're going to get hurt. And I always ask myself, you spend so many times to get your legal degree, you're going through this training, you land up in court, they say you're an advocate, and in 2 years you're almost in jail. What the heck is up with that? Don't do it. Don't do it. Do things legally. That's the advocates we want in South Africa. That's the advocates we want on the bench. When advocates goes on the bench, attorneys, professors, those people also going on the bench nowadays. And if you go into politics, shouldn't talk politics. We want these kinds of advocates to go into politics because they're good people and they know what we need. They have integrity, honesty, solid platform. All right, going on. The referral rule. Prohibition, that's paragraph 4. We're merging into paragraph 4.1. Prohibition against receiving instructions directly from the public. I don't think I'm going to talk about that now again because we already did it under undertakings. This was the same side of things. Because if you look at paragraph 3.7 under the Hawks case, admissions and undertakings made and settlement concluded by counsel on behalf of clients. So what he did is he did that. He didn't have instruction. Those things were all illegal. Go read that court case. And basically, it's the same when prohibition against receiving instructions directly from public. I touched on that, but you can go and read a court case of the Freitas versus Society of Advocates of Natal of 2001 there, where it happened, and he was charged with unprofessional conduct. So go and look at that court case. So I smacked two flies with one swatter. Is it called the swatter? I hope so. Paragraph 4.2, counsel should not perform work within the exclusive ambit of the functions of an attorney. Ach, a simple example is, how can an advocate be a conveyancer? Come, tell me now, I want to know too. So those are things you cannot do. If you go and look at the General Council of Bar of South Africa versus Roseman of 2002, you shall see in the Magistrates Court, the counsel signed two particulars of claims and later two notices of motions, which you couldn't sign. And of course, it ripped the whole case apart when that was found out, because you know, you do know that these things are always found out later on, and then the damage is worse. Am I right, guys? Am I right? So please, counsel should not perform work with the exclusive ambit of the functions of attorneys. There's even things that trust-bearing advocates cannot do that attorneys are doing. So be careful. Have a look at that, please. All right, guys? Right, I'm paging. Okay. It seems there is page numbers after all. So I'm on page 6 now. Paragraph 5. Rules governing consultations, witnesses, and cross-examination. They talk there about consultation to take place in the council chambers and in the presence of an instructing attorney and exceptions to the general rule. Years ago, this wasn't so strict, but people expected that. I remember years ago, I used to go out to attorneys. They invite me, but this is quite correct. Your chambers, if you're an independent advocate or the chambers, the bar, that's where you meet. All right? Consultations take place in counsel's chambers and in the presence of instructing attorney, exceptions to the general rule. This is an interesting thing. I'm reading something here. Are you picking it up? In the presence of the instruction attorney. I've had many, when attorneys get to trust you, I had many attorneys that say, oh, can you sit alone with them? I know. You know divorce is backwards. We've seen you in action. And I'm like, oh, you know, exceptions to the rule. So go and look at those exceptions. And if I can give you a tip here, make certain that's in writing. So, you know, I'll do it for you, but put it in writing and let's just make certain we meet the requirements in terms of the exceptions. Remember, at the end of the day, the attorney controls that case. And if he's not there, the first thing that happens, listen to me, I've been through this before, is that, so we're talking there, and the attorney has said this, and I say, but I think, you know, that or that. Client runs back to the attorney, says, the advocate says you're wrong, we must do this and this. Immediate fight. So those are things you must stay away from. 5.2 talks about the interviewing of witnesses of an opponent. You've got to be so careful of this. I did a criminal case there somewhere in Limpopo also, and I'm cross-examining the state witness. My attorney is sitting right beside me, and as we walk out when we break for lunch or whatever, my attorney of record says to me, hey, is he talking to the state witness? I turn around, he's talking to the state witness. And he's talking to him in his language. And I was like, what the heck? So I walked out, I said, stop this. Yeah, but he's just telling the guy how to maintain himself in a box. And I say, you cannot do that. Part of me cross-examining is putting him on pressure. The way he maintains in court is my strategy to force him to contradict himself if there's truth in the fact that he can contradict himself. We landed up in the magistrate's office. That was bad. He lied, said, never did it. Said he spoke to me English, we could hear what he was saying. He blatantly lied. Luckily, we also went on to win that case, which was a little bit of retribution, I think. You stay away. You stay away. Let's look at Shabalala. Key others versus the Tenet. That comes out of Transvaal, Attorney General Transvaal. It's a very good case that's still applicable. It comes out of 1996. And it basically has to do with no permission of Attorney General or prosecutor and meeting the requirements. If you don't have the permission of the people in power today, the prosecutor, National Prosecution Authority, as well as sometimes if you don't know whether it is a witness or not, you must phone the IO, investigating officer, and say, is this a witness? Are you before you can talk to them? So guys, this is very, 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 very dangerous. Don't muck around and interview witnesses of the opponent. If you don't meet the requirements, you don't have the permissions. You can railroad your whole case right there and then. Telling me now, he's telling him to maintain himself in the box. I had another case. Listen to this. Years ago, here in Pretoria, Mac Court, I'm cross-examining. And as I'm cross-examining, I can see the truth is going to come up. He breaks, and just before he breaks, prosecutor jumps up and says, whoa, 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 whoa. I object, and I think we must break now. Yes, but that magistrate had my ear. Because what he did there was totally, totally illegal. It's up to the magistrates to stop me. And he's intervening in that split second. And we came back, and the guy was calm, and I couldn't break him. I had to use the foundation of witnesses to go to take the case further to my client's benefit. All right, interesting stuff. Listening to the stories. So I love telling stories to advocates, that's pupils, because this is how you learn. This is how you get an idea of, oh, so that's what I'm getting myself into. All right. Paragraph 5.3, my apologies. Undesirability of counsel deposing to affidavits and becoming a witness in cases. Interesting thing is, when I was in chambers, we never used to certify advocates' documentation on the same floor as us, because later you can call to testify. You're sitting on the same floor, or you're sitting in an office next to you, and it's uncomfortable if it's a bad one. Do you understand what I'm saying? So undesirable of counsel deposing to affidavits and becoming a witness in the case, stay away from it. Stay away from it. All right? That is very logical. Can a defendant man be a witness? I've seen cases where the magistrate said, no, we have to call the attorney into the box. It's undesirable. They say it's undesirable because, strictly speaking, it can be done. It's undesirable. All right. Have a look at that. The Karoolis versus Sambo bank case of 2002 is a good example of that. Moving on to 5.4, interviewing witness during trial. And interviewing witnesses after they've been sworn in. Guys, be very careful of the general provision against the interviewing witness who are under cross-examination, as well as pinterest and re-examination. Be very careful of that. Have a look at that. Go and read the codes on it. And you'll see a lot of the codes is indicative of the fact that, yes, indeed, it is generally undesirable. Now, I want you to understand, when I say undesirable, doesn't mean it's illegal. But it's generally undesirable. Because in the other case, I made a note in my closing argument of, I draw the court's attention to this date and date when I cross-examined and the prosecutor jumped up. And when he came back, our story dramatically changed. And I want to bring the court's attention to that. That in itself has broken down that testimony and that credibility. And that action by the state is an infringement on a fair right trial of my client. I went all over that and it worked. Because what he did was illegal. So here also, it's undesirable. It's not illegal. But you can use undesirability to your benefit in a closing argument. Say, hey, this happened. Please, I want the court to remember. Did you see how he swung around in his testimony after he had his break? Or even after the prosecutor saved him for 60 seconds? Just breaking my concentration, because now we're fighting here. He's standing in the box looking at us. And he's listening to what a prosecutor is saying. And he's picking up leads. Yes. My dear beloved pupils, that's what you're getting yourself into. Enjoy. 5.5, cross-examination. Again, the same case as previously mentioned. President of the Republic of South Africa and others versus South Africa, Rugby Football Union, Key Others 2000. Cross-examination dealing with witnesses on a cross-examination. This basically has to do with when they're lying. When I'm cross-examining and the indication is that they are lying, if you go and read that case, this part of it, and you will see here, para 61 to 63, that means you only, this court case we're using a lot, she only reads those paragraphs. Here they had to do with the situation, if, well, you know, we insinuating for crossing, you're lying, you're a liar. You cannot say that to people in the box, eh? I did it once, I was in trouble. So, but this is not true, this is untruth. There is now a double verse, what? It has to do with the fact that you must give them the opportunity to explain themselves. All right? Say, all right, well, explain yourself. There's now many verses in front of the court. Why? Why did you say this there 2 days ago, now this, now that? And go read this court case on a cross-examination. Because cross-examination is to break a person. To bring the truth out, or to show that the person on inconsistencies is not credit worthy. All right. Have a look at that, please. All right, so on paragraph 6, we're moving on to rules governing counsel fees. The first thing that comes to mind is the Road Accident Fund. A couple of advocates went down about 10 years ago. One of them was my mentor, great advocate. He's the reason I'm an advocate today, because I was an article clerk at the lawyer's firm. He walked in and said, hey, what are you doing here? And I said, oh, well, I'm doing articles. He said, you shouldn't be an article. You're going to become a lawyer. I said, oh, well, no, I was thinking advocate. That's actually why I started this journey. He says, no, man. He makes a phone call. I have an interview. And guess what? I'm an advocate today. They were all involved in the Road Accident Fund. And he was my mentor. They actually did it. They came clean. They said, I was just like double charging. All those. It wasn't even newspapers. You will remember it. Very well-known case. Fees. Council fees. Road Accident Fund. Remember, you cannot overcharge. You cannot undercharge. You cannot overvalue and undervalue your services. That's actually the correct terminologies. Isn't that correct, Mrs. Rustov? I'm sure you read that in the multi-choice of 04. So there I talk about that. Contingency fee agreement, South African Association of Personal Injury Lawyers versus Minister of Justice and Constitutional Development, Road Accident Fund, Intervening Party 2013. And if you take the abbreviation there, it's SSAPIL. These people came to court and they said that at 25% you get in contingency fee agreements. That limit, they asked the court to say no, they must abolish it. That it's unconstitutional. They had the whole argument there. Council fees. They say, no, we can ask. If I go into a contingency fee and I later say it's very complicated, now I don't want 25% anymore. I want 50%, and that should be fine. And what did the court do? You've guessed it. They chased them away. So that is contingency fee agreements for you. Pro bono and pro amico briefs. I'm just going to be quick about this. Pro bono cases. As an advocate, you can be forced to do pro bono or you can decide to do pro bono from time to time. You cannot do too many of them because you've got to travel expenses, but I did a lot of pro bono cases. And some of my cases were paying cases where I walked away and said, you don't have to pay me, so it turned into a pro bono. So pro bono is for free. And sometimes you just want to help somebody and they can't afford it. But what happened with me, and I want to caution you about this, attorneys, now the course coordinator of this course is attorney Beeston, Michelle Beeston. She's the big boss. We report to her. She's an attorney. She's going to hate me for saying this. If I say attorneys, I'm in trouble because then I reflect negatively upon them. But what happened with me is some of my attorneys picked up that I'm generous. And you know what happened? They started phoning me, oh, can you do this case for free? Can you do that case for free? And it became a problem in my chambers because I was a guy that cared and I liked to help. And even that became a problem. So please be selective about pro bono. If it's pro bono, make certain it's not a big case. It's going to cost you a lot of money. Be careful with pro bono. The attorneys, like bloodsuckers somewhere. I respect them. I love them. They are the bread of an advocate's income. Never forget that. But some of those guys, there was a friend of mine. And with one, I still said, yeah, how can you phone me about this every day? You know I have to pay bills. You know I have to live. No, no, sorry, James. I said, no, man, come now. And later years, actually, I started learning to limit it. What is Pro Amico Briefs? That is like Amicus Curia. Do you know what the Amicus Curia is? Do you remember President Jacob Zuma's rape case? Do you remember that case? Do you remember there was Joinders, Amicus Curia? That was institutions that monitor rape on women and violence. And those are people that comes into your case to support it on another foundation. And then that is, those are the amico briefs. We refer to them either as the amicus briefs, or we refer to them as the amico briefs. So you got a pro bono, and you don't, then you have them. You can pay there, don't worry about that. All right? So that's important. I just wanted to bring that also under your attention. Champetus agreements. I'm going to talk to you out of the first about Champetus agreements. You can go and read the court case Price Waterhouse Coopers Incorporated and others versus National Potato Cooperative Limited 2004. Champetus agreements are very interesting. This is an agreement where somebody that's got nothing to do with the case comes and pays for the case for you to prosecute the action. And then when you win, they later get a share, big share. Now, the first thing I want to say about Champetus agreements is when you read up on it, you'll see it's illegal. Then later on, when you go and look at case precedent like PricewaterhouseCoopers, they say, well, it's not totally illegal because constitutionally you all have the freedom of freedom of contracting. So there's nothing illegal about a contract like this. Well, you know, I'll pay for your court case, but if you win, I'll take 99% and you get freaking 1%. So the courts decided, well, okay, if it's not illegal, then we must be careful where it's a ripoff. Because constitutionally, we have the right to contract. I love law. Don't you love law? Look how everything fits into each other. And so when you go read this course, you'll see that you must just make certain that when that's done, they actually talk, I wrote it down here, the poor suitor. They say if it's there to help the poor suitor that really needs this, he cannot afford it, nobody's making a massive profit out of it, really to help the guy, then they argue that Champetus agreements will be legal. So please go ahead. And actually, there was Judge Cameron, one of your big judges, excellent judge, much respect for him, was the one that actually ruled this and set it up logically. Say, guys, whoa, whoa, whoa. You can't say it's totally illegal, but here's where we're going with this. All right, so that's Champetus agreements, so be careful of that. I want to say to you, be careful of that, because it can impact on you in terms of fees. It can impact on the counsel and an attorney too. All right, so be careful of that. Then cost the bonus proprietors and other disentitling counsel to charge. Go and read January versus Standard Bank of South Africa 2010. There was gross negligence, and only when guilty of improper conduct. So there must be gross negligence, there must be negligence. And only guilty, found guilty of that, of those elements that make you guilty of that, then the bonus de prise can be ordered. What is the bonus de prise? Well, it means that there was such negligence by the legal practitioner, he's going to pay the cost or he's going to pay part of the cost. Most of the orders I've observed, and I've asked for orders like this against legal practitioners in the past, usually say, well, 50% the client pays, 50% the attorneys pay. And nowadays, I've seen court cases where advocates, attorneys, everybody, you can all be under this. So you must just have a look at that. So what is cost the bonus proprius? It's when you don't do your work. You do your work half, you're negligent. And then such an order can be made. Hang in there, we're almost there. About two pages left, I think. Paragraph 6.5. Fee agreements must, the reasonableness of counsel fees, making briefs, and finishing fee accounts. Fees has to be reasonable, but when you go look at the Legal Practice Act now, you'll see that there's a lot of requirements and they're forcing us to go to estimations. I don't like that. But how otherwise are you going to estimate costs? I don't know what's going to happen in court case. So fees must be reasonable. But here I want to talk to you about something that's interesting here. If you go and look at a case of Henny de Beer, Game Lord CC versus Waterbok, Bosveld Plaas CC, and another 2010, this is interesting. Because they talk about time-related feeing, and they say, no. We don't like this concept of time-related feeing, because if I charge per hour, which in any event we do, then I can actually escalate the bill. We're not too concerned about that too, as long as I don't escalate it maliciously. I must ask for what I'm doing. But here's the problem of time-related fee charging. A guy that doesn't know his business, he's putting up a poor case, this advocate. It's taking him 2 weeks to put everything together because he doesn't really know what he's doing. But he gets paid R1,000, R100,000. And I, the time-related fee I'm setting up for the same case, I know what I'm doing. 3 hours, I'm finished. I'm getting R2,000-R3,000. And that's what I'm talking about. Fees must be reasonable. How did I deal with it? How can I advise you? What I used to do to people is I used to say, I work for that amount of money per hour, but I'm not going to ask over R50,000. There I cap it. Especially when I do criminal investigations. I go to the clients and say, well, it's going to be R250,000 on the eve hour, but I can cap it for you at R100,000. They're happy with that. So it must be reasonable. So go read this court case and get on top of this. Because especially advocates have a habit of asking unreasonable fees. All right? Attorneys are still good here. Hey, Mrs. Beeston, attorneys are still good here. I'm saying, Mrs. Rustoff, I'm saying to Mrs. Beeston, they're great guys. Hey, if you're an advocate, you must have a humor. Remember that. All right, in any event, go and look at this. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? And that, and then, of course, putting up a bad case can also then again later on result in a the bonus per piece order. All right. Paragraph 7. Guys, really, I've got nothing against attorneys. I just worked for a few, about 2% my whole life, that I'll never in my life again work for. And I suppose, let's be realistic. I suppose this attorney's out and say, ah, that's a good law. I'll never work with that guy again. Yeah. So it comes around, goes around. Right. Paragraph 7. Counsel's qualified privilege and freedom of speech in court. Guys, here I want to make a serious appeal to you. In the last 2 to 3 years, we've had one advocate down in Cape Town. He was defending the mafia. And he was late for a court case, and he used vulgar language under the dress of females in the way he accosted the judge. You have a qualified privilege and freedom of speech in court. That is not it. There's a couple of advocates that really lost their temper. Mrs. Rustoff, didn't we see that? Guys, didn't we see that now in the case of Jacob Zuma? Where a derogatory remark was made against one of the counsels by another counsel. Yes, that was a month or two ago. There it is. So please, guys, respect the court, respect the officers and work over them. Don't get into abusive language except if the abusive language is part and parcel of the trial. Now, years ago, before the Constitutional Court ruled adultery unconstitutional, and it's still my belief it's not totally unconstitutional. It's unconstitutional. You cannot bring it anymore. But I've read a couple of court cases I agree with. There is dramatic instances there and damages claims. But in any event, let's leave that for something else. And there was a telephone call that was made on speakerphone. The husband of the wife with whom the adultery by a third party was committed brought somebody into his office to listen as a witness. So he phoned this guy on the speakerphone and he said, "Hey, you're sleeping with my wife." And they hit each other and all this bad language. And the guy said, "Man, it was nice with your wife." And he went on to precisely say what he did with the wife, and I don't want to get into that now. It was of an explicit sexual nature, very graphic. So I'm in court in front of the late Judge Els, and I have this witness in the box, and he has to now confirm the specific words, the language, what he did. Okay, let's leave it there. You know, right, okay. Your imagination can't even get to it, okay. So I have him in a box and he doesn't want to testify, and I push him and eventually he starts to testify. And he's using these terminologies that was said over the phone. That you can do. And due to that, I won that case. That was such a big case I won. People outside the High Supreme Court auditorium were doing it on the pavement. It was a big victory for me. And later years, they took adultery off the books. There you go, that's how it goes. So in any event, you have qualified privilege. You can't say you must be respectful. You must be respectful. I was in court, I think, last year on an eviction case in Johannesburg, and the young female advocate had an argument with the judge's clerk. And when the judge called the case up, he said, "Listen, you lied to my clerk." And she was like, "Hey, I did not." And they clashed. And I was very upset about it because the language that was used from the junior advocate was not good. But she was upset. I immediately realized that her facts was true. You'll see, it's going to happen to you. You know, advocate for years, you know who's lying and not lying. But the way she addressed it, and I like the judge, very good judge. And unfortunate, they were going to refer it to the judge's commission. And stuff like that. Please, counsel's qualified privilege. It must not be abusive. It must be part and parcel of what you're doing there. You don't engage in that. Eh? There is restrictions on everything in life, isn't there? All right, coming to the end on paragraph 9. Court and professional ethic. You can go and look at that. How you dress, how you speak. We teach you all of those things. There's only one way you can really pick it up. Go to court, all right? Bow. Don't just storm into a court. Bow backwards, bow in. All right. Make certain you have the right dress code on. All right. Make certain that your Batman suit is ironed. All right, your robe. Make certain it's ironed. I was in court one day. This is long ago. I remember it so clearly. An advocate for Port Elizabeth flew up like a party. That morning, I sat beside him in court and I could smell him. And he had a rope on. I don't know what he did with it. Maybe he slept in it. And when he jumped out, he was in front of no other than just Southworth. That's a judge. You talk about the judge. And I could see the disdain on that judge's face. And they actually stood that matter down. I don't want to know what happened in chambers, but I could smell him. And that rope, it was so, what do you call it? It wasn't ironed. It was bad. And I felt insulted as an advocate. He didn't shave. The beard was coming out halfway. I just thought, but we're advocates. The community looks at us. The attorneys looked at us. How can we act like this? I was really disgusted with that colleague of mine. So that's court and professional ethics. Look at that. Have your shoes, everything clean, man. Come on. Remember, one thing, and never forget this. The attorney says to the client, "We're going to see the advocate." The client is like, "Ooh." And she goes back to Francis. The attorney says, "We're going to see the advocate." You walk in there, you look like an idiot. You act like an idiot. They're expecting power there. They're expecting knowledge there. They're expecting resolution there. They're expecting confidence there. Don't disappoint. Right, we're going on there to number 9 still, yes. That is a duty to obey the rules of the profession. Well, that's what we have been doing. I want to take you to Society of Advocates of South Africa versus Sickler, 1976. Advocates must uphold and endorse all rules, because if they don't, it creates an unfair trial and it creates injustice. Anytime you don't enforce and uphold the rule, luckily, these new court cases that came out. Judges are saying to advocates, "We're sick and tired of you sidestepping the rules. And from now on, we're going to be very stern." That court case is now coming out. You have circumvented the rule. We're going to deal with you. Stick to the rules. Applications for admission and enrollment as an advocate. Let me talk about it. I wanted to talk about it when we started off, because there was a code called, do you remember we spoke about you in an ex parte application, you must bring all the material facts? Now, you being admitted is an ex parte application. And this is what I'm talking about. If you go to the Northern Cape Society versus Mr. Aku 2018, he didn't reveal his criminal record. And he argued, but that's not material. But he was asked for it. So please, in ex parte applications and in the applications, if you begin an advocate, if you have a criminal record, you must tell them so they can make a decision about it. And if you went in for therapy or you've done your time of whatever you have done, maybe you had the parole officer, I don't know, get their statements, attach it. not to say you're not going to become an advocate. In certain instances, they will not allow this. Certain things, if you've done it, you're not going to become an advocate. But if you have done something, it's not that bad. Get statements. Build your application with supporting and confirmatory affidavits. In this case, supporting. But you must show you have a criminal record, amongst other things. So these two rules of conduct, do you see they merge? Now remember, in your practical exam assignment, the first ones that has to be in there, I spoke about at the beginning of this, we've given you as a draft your full application to become a legal practitioner as well as an advocate, because it's a two-leg application. They can be independently or together to the court. You're going to use your own personal information. Why? This is the one you're going to use. You're going to come back and say, I already drafted it. Maybe give it to somebody to just look at it. Use your correct information so that I can go through it and see, yeah, well, if you pass your admission exams, your supervisor gives you a certificate, this application you can actually take like this and give it in. And you must set it up as though you have everything. Don't come and say, but I don't have this yet. When you do this instruction for us, it's like, yeah, I have everything, and you just hypothetically build it in. There it is, sir. You got to tell the court what's going on in your life. Going into paragraph 11, seems like the last one. Applications to strike off and concept of fit and proper person to practice. You don't want to know how many court cases there of what is fit and proper, but in the pupil guide, we've told you. We have shown you court cases. We have shown you what is fit and proper. So applications to strike off and concept of fit and proper person to practice. You can go and read there. A court case of Johannesburg Society of Advocates versus Edeling of 2019, where an advocate was admitted and he was applying for readmission, but he has a serious problem with dishonesty. So what is the requirement? The court is looking at what we call reformation. And has the reformation been completed? And I found in this case, no. So what does this mean? It means that you were struck off the roll for something, this case serious dishonestly. They want to know if you have changed. So if you're being an admission application like that, that is what you're going to prove reformation, and you're going to have to use the terminology reformation. That's what's important for me to convey to you. Reformation is very important in that sense, all right? So that's what I want to look at. I want to look at those things. So, and they say then, of course, you've got to prove that. Let me just read it again. Applications to strike off and concept of fit and proper person to practice. So you're coming back now, and they want to see change. I mean, I can be practical. The first thing I would do there is I would have a psychiatrist, a psychologist report to say that I've changed. I'm not dishonest anymore. And that's just the one case on serious dishonesty. Can be for other reason. You have to supplement your application to empower the court to grant you the readmission. But in this case, they say this guy was almost like an alcoholic in terms of dishonesty. Couldn't stop. And so that is one case. It was in 2019. Phew. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed it. It's code of conduct for your pupils specifically. For you that's going to go through as pupils and start going to court. And of course, applying for admission and all of those things. So this is very important to you. And I have tremendously enjoyed myself. From myself and Mrs. Roofstof sitting here beside me, thank you for having us. It was a tremendous joy to be here. And in my time next week, I'm going to be back and I'm going to start talking to you about practical drafting on that book you have to buy, specifically intellectual claims and damages. And then in the time I'm sitting here, because your time and my time when you're seeing this is not the same. Next week I'm doing, and a week after that I'm doing 10 hours actually, on advanced contract drafting. So those are the three things that we have to cover with you. So those clips will be available. Look out for them and make certain that you don't get into the exam and they ask you to draft a surety and you cannot do it. Or they ask you to draft a particular claim in terms of deluxe claim or damages sustained, and you cannot do it. All right. So that is the reason why we're also going to say that after. By the time you see my first clip, then most probably these clips will also be available. Thank you very much. Have a great one. I'm out of here, and you'll see my next clip as soon as I'm back here.